Good afternoon to all of you. May I request Professor S.S. Sangha to lead the guest onto the dais. First, Professor Anant Agarwal, Padma Shri Anant Agarwal. Dr. A.H. Ramarao, Dr. P. Sadanandamaya, Dr. Anita Kuru, Dr. Baldev Raj, the Director of NIAS. We start the program with invocation.
Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Marutah Stunvanti Divyai Stavaihi Vedai Sangha Padakramo Panishadaihi Gayanti Yam Samagah Dhyana Vastita Tadgatena Manasa Pashyanti Yam Yoginah Yasyantam Navidusura Suraganah Devaya Tasmai Namaha Namaste Satete Jagat Karanaya Namaste Chite Sarvalokashrayaya Namo Dvaita Tattvaya Mukti Pradaya Namo Brahmane Vyapine Shashvataya Twamekam Sharanyam Twamekam Varenyam Twamekam Jagat Palakam Swaprakasham Twamekam Jagat Kartra Patra Prahartra Twamekam Param Nishalam Nirvikalpam Vayam Twam Smaramo Vayam Twam Bhajamaha Vayam Twam Jagat Sakshirupam Namamaha Sadekam Nidanam Niralam Bamisham Bhavam Bodhipotam Sharanyam Vrajamaha Yontah pravishya mama vacha mimam prasuptam Sanjeeva yatyakhila shakti dhara swadhamna Anyam shahasta charana shravana tvagadin Prana namo bhagavate purushaya tubhyam Tvameva mata cha pita tvameva Tvameva bandhoscha sakha tvameva Tvameva vidya dravinan tvameva Tvameva sarvam mama deva deva Sarve cha sukhinas santu Sarve santu niramayaha Sarve bhadrani pashyantu Makasche dukha bhag bhavet.
Thank you, Venkat and Nagaraj. Now I request Professor Anita Kuru to give a brief introduction. She is currently the leading National Gifted Education Program Chair, anchored at NIAS, and she has been awarded Fulbright Nehru Research Scholarship for the year 2011-12 and was hosted at the University of California, Davis.
Good evening and a warm welcome to each one of you in this hall. I'll give you a brief introduction of the National Program on Gifted Education. The National Program on Gifted Education is anchored at the National Institute of Advanced Studies. It was a program that was initiated by the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor to Government of India. The program aims to identify children who have exceptional abilities in one or more domains so that it places that child in the top 1% of their own age peer group. This is a unique program because the current formal education system that we have in the country does not have any facilities to either identify these children or provide them the required mentorship. Over the last few years, the program has been focusing on developing Indian-based protocols to identify the gifted children for a diverse country like India. Currently, we have a standardized protocol that we use to identify these children in the age group of 3 to 15 years. As part of this program, we got into a collaboration with the Iyengar Foundation and the National College Baswangudi to try and identify children who are gifted in the age group of 16 to 18 years. We think those are critical years where children make decisions of the kind of careers they have to take. And during this process, many of the children who do not have the advantage of the required social network, who come from rural and tribal areas, really miss out simply because they do not get the kind of opportunities that they need to get. Three institutions, the Iyengar Foundation, the National Institute of Advanced Studies, and the National College have come together to see if we can create a program that will give these children the lifelong mentoring that they require. The program was launched in 2017, and Professor C.N.R. Rao was the chief guest for the program. Today we have with us Dr. Anant Agarwal Padma Shri, who is the CEO of EdX. So this program for us is extremely close to our heart, and this year we have had about, the first program was started with 10 fellowships that was sponsored by Dr. Sadananda Maya. This year we had 30 fellowships that were sponsored by Dr. Sadananda Maya, Dr. Iyengar, and Dr. Baldev Raj, who is the director of NIAS, in the name of his mother Amrit. So we had 30 fellowships that were available, which gives a cash award of about rupees 50,000. That is not the important point. The point is providing these children the mentoring. Although we had about 30 fellowships, we were very clear that we will not bring the mark in terms of what we would think is a gifted child. And hence, we selected only 15 students. So it is not the availability of scholarship that would decide the number of children who get this fellowship, but children of excellence, we will find the fellowship for them. That is the spirit with which this program is moving forward, and we are extremely happy that all of you all are here and you're going to enjoy a wonderful program. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Anita Kurup. May I request the dignitaries to light the lamp and inaugurate this second talent search program. May I request Dr. Baldev Raj, Director NIAS, to offer his welcome remarks. Dr. Baldev Raj.
It's near good evening, so let me say good evening rather than good afternoon. It's 5 minutes before good evening. Welcome, Dr. Anant Agarwal. It's so kind of you to agree to come. It's a very special occasion for the children, the parents, the teachers, and all of us. And we see that you are just the right person to be able to addressing these audience. And we are delighted, and we are all looking forward to be there. Professor Iyengar, Professor Rama Rao, my colleague, Professor Anita, Professor Dr. Maya, Dr. Venugopal, I think it's a team in which we have been working. And we believe that always in the history, it is a few who have transformed, and the others have taken the pleasure to follow these leaders. The journey has been equally stimulating and enjoying for the leaders and those who followed. So we are looking for young children who have something in them which reflects in their eyes, which reflects in their body language, which reflects in the dance of their neurons, and which reflects in everything they do. So we, a group of small people, when we sit together, we only look at the child. If we fall in love with this child, he is a gifted. If we find that we are liking a child, this child is excellent in studies, but somehow does not have something which is exceptional, which is extraordinary at that age, then that child will say, sorry, we have not been able to identify. Maybe we have made a mistake, but you would be as gifted as we wish you to be. And my first expression is that please, please, the parents and teachers, don't give the impression to these children that you have already achieved what you are to achieve. And secondly, that those who didn't get it, they were no less. It so happened that we sort of interacted for a short time. We went through all what we had. But I think always in the sense of gifted, it is not very easy to decide. So having said that, congratulations to the children who have come in this mentorship program. If it is to be unique, as Professor Anita said, it is that we stay with you. Now that you are a part of this family, you would go through ups and downs, you would go through great excitement, you would go through sometimes a little embarrassment, maybe go sometimes below your expectations or this thing. Don't worry about that. We are a part of family. We are going to stay as a team with you. This institute belongs to everyone. That is how it was instituted. G.R.D. Tata, about 30 years back, thought that the challenges before the country and indeed the Earth planet are so large that we need the best of the minds in culture, social sciences, humanities, education, science, technologies, policies, politics, any discipline you talk about. We need a combination of scholars to be able to address that problem. Whether it is inequality, whether it is healthcare not being available at affordable cost, be it nutritious food, be it the pollution or the climate change, or whatever it is, we need a combination of the people to come together to dialogue and dialect. So we keep on looking at those of the issues which are not addressed properly. So if you go to our website, you would find that we look at the issues which we want to carry forward. My friend Professor Ricky K is here. He's a Grammy Award winner, sitting silently. I think he can enrich and enhance this whole place multifold, but he's sitting very silently at this stage.
He has to sing.
So if you request, he would sing, I'm sure. So, you see, these are the quality people. When Ricky K says that I want to connect music with the sustainability of the Earth planet, he becomes our dear colleague and we start working. So any of you in the audience who feel that you have a dream for the country, please do talk to us at NEAS. We would be interested to carry forward your dream. This belongs to everyone. This institute doesn't belong only to the faculty, students, and the people who work here. It belongs indeed to the whole world. So I request you that you come forward. Second thing is that to make a difference to the world is not in the biodata, is not in the decorations and distinctions. It is touching the citizens of the planet. Anything less than that is not a contribution by any standard. So it is very important that as these gifted children grow up, we mentor them. It is not going to be only in their area where they peak, be it mathematics, be it physics, be it music, or be it anything. It is to make them responsible, ethical citizens. The world's problems are not because of lack of science and technology. The world's problems are not because of lack of money available. It is not because of lack of the brains available. It is the lack of the ethics collectively. Fortunately, there are enough number of good people on the planet who make this planet go round and round, and we see all the manifestations. It is very important for us to engage the young children, their parents, their teachers, to have the ecosystem in which the ethics would make a very positive slope. In the same very hall, to a very similar audience, a few years back, His Excellency Dalai Lama came, who is a distinguished fellow of our institute. He talked for 1 hour, interacted. Then one person from the audience said, "What do you see as the future of this planet?" He said, "Future is very good, and I am very optimistic." Then somebody asked, "Why do you say so?" He says, "Young children, if we take care of them and just mentor them and do nothing, the world would do great." So I think all of us must understand that we have one role, to do what has been assigned to us, but in addition, mentor these young children. Not that you can sit quiet and just mentor these children, that is not the way forward. Do our job very well and then mentor these children. I think we are very safe. And we need not worry too much what the media, press, or anybody else is talking. Thank you very much for coming this evening. And it's wonderful to have you and these gifted children, all their associates. I wish them very, very best.
Thank you, sir, for your kind and inspirational words. May I request Dr. H. Ramarao, president of NES institutions, to address the gathering.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Incidentally, Dr. S. Sitaramayya, who is sitting on the dais, Dr. P. Sadanamaya, the first mover of this NEAS Maya Prodigy program, and Dr. Raghottam Rao, Krishnamurti, and all the people who are sitting are the alumni of the great institution, the National College or the National Education Society, which has just now celebrated its existence of 100 years by inviting the Honorable President of India, Ramnath Kovind, on Saturday. I am fresh from that memory, you know. Maybe a few years back, when I talked to Dr. Sita Mayangar, my idea was to help the Indian students to get prizes like Nobel Prize or Turing Awards or something like that, catch them young for that. Then after discussion, Dr. Sitaram Mayangar, Dr. Maya, and Dr. Baldev Rao, Dr. Anita Kroop, we evolved this one, that is NEAS Maya Prodigy. Everybody knows what is NEAS, National Institute of Advanced Studies. But Maya, everybody knows as Dr. Sadananda Maya. But there's some more meaning to it. Mentoring to accelerate individual youth achievement in promoting development of India's gifted young. Like that we started. Just imagine, to support such a program on the first day, it's very difficult. Second day, some 2 people will come. Third day, 10 will come. Fourth day, 15 will come. On a centenary day, so many people will come. But the first day, Dr. P. Sadanandamai has come, and he instituted the scholarships. We had to give him an applause. Of course, these students, 15 students are there. First, I will congratulate them. I think they first put their step, or first walked in, to the National College rooms, you know, to take the exam. The memory is there for them. And such an institution for 100 years has provided modern technocentric education for more than 15 lakh children, not one or two. All round 360 degree growth of students who enter our portals is a priority. Extracurricular activity in sports, fine arts, and culture are encouraged as much as academic work. You know, legendary Anil Kumble is our student, National College student, you know. And A.S. Kiran Kumar, the secretary of the space ISRO, was our student. Our matinee idol, Vishnuvardhan, was our student. I'm justifying what Dr. Baldev Raj said, you know. We are encouraged in all round, you know, science and liberal arts completely. Only thing is, one or two things I may forget, that's all. In doing so, we are adhered to the highest standards of morality and integrity. I think that is missing nowadays. We help students dream big. That's what we did for you. Set lofty goals and build confidence. We instill a sense of humanism, that's more important, nationalism and patriotism in them. We not only inspire, but also mentor and motivate our students into passionately pursuing their dreams, whatever their dream they have, a Nobel Prize winning, or a Turing Award winning, or becoming the best actor, or starting a course like Hour of Code, as initiated Mark Zuckerberg, or President Obama, or Yusuf Malala, whatever be the name. See, that is our aim at National College, and almost you are invited to the portals of National College. One more thing, you know, in the National College, you have got what's called the Bangalore Science Forum, started in 1962. I don't know whether you were born in those days. Today it is 2018. And we started, Dr. Nisimia started that one with a clear idea of having one science lecture on Wednesday. No date, no month, no year. It's only Wednesday. Not even a single Wednesday is let off. Nobel laureates, Dorothy Hodgkin, or Jules Hoffman, or Nigeshi, some names I'm getting it, they are given the lectures. FRS are given lectures. Bharatratna C.N.R. Rao, in fact, who helped us to formulate this program, he has given lectures. We had yesterday and Wednesday. Some people came there. They saw one person by name Dr. Karthik Hosnagar from Wharton Business Management School, you know, Pennsylvania University, very top university. And when he was talking to me, when I told him this thing, he told me that one or two things about him. He is the co-founder of Yodel Incorporation, a venture-backed firm recently listed among the top 50 fastest growing private firms in the US. This is important for you, 15 people there, and also young engineering graduates on this side. Helped startups, or was the original seed investor in several student startups, note the word, out of Wharton, including web startups, Homeboodle, Milo, Clipic, and New TV. In fact, he is one of the youngest tenured professors at the Wharton School. His academic research work focuses on internet commerce, which is important to you, with a special emphasis on digital media and internet marketing strategies. Recent work investigates how digital media influences consumer choice and how firms can better use new media in their marketing efforts. There were about 200 people there. 45 minutes talked about these things, and 1 hour discussion. He has to go back to America. Then he told me on the stage, so next time when I come, you give the whole day as a workshop for the youngsters. And if you want, he has given me his email. You can immediately have a contact with him and take him as a mentor. You may not know there's a mentor site in America. They charge fee like anything. But here is a free mentor site. You can go to Dr. Karthik directly and he'll mentor in any of these things, which is a broad-based one. In fact, he likes lots of learning and lots of laughing. I think people like that one. He's not laughing. He is ready to guide you, and it's for you to pick up. So that's what we are doing at the National College, or Bangalore Science Forum, or Bangalore Social Science Forums, or Bangalore Ethical Parishad. Science, liberal arts, music. Wherever you want, you can put your hand, I can become very big. With this introductory remarks, today I welcome all of you.
Thank you very much, sir. Now may I request Professor S.S. Iyengar, renowned professor from Florida International University, the brainchild of this program, to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Anant Agarwal.
Well, greetings to all of you, and it is indeed an honor and a privilege to introduce a very young, distinguished researcher, entrepreneur, and a whole lot of things. By name Dr. Anant Agarwal. So I'm just going to make the stories very short, because I think all of you have heard about the need to inspire younger generation, you know, the transformation. You know, I've been in United States for 45 years. There's always a colleague of mine here or there will always say, Ram, tell me, when are you getting a Nobel Prize from India? So my response to that is, there are a lot of bright people, you know, and Anant Agarwal is one of the brightest person of younger generation in United States. So I'm going to read a little bit of a biography, because I had met Professor Agarwal when I visited several years back. Professor Lozano Perez, I used to do work on autonomous systems, but he may have forgotten, because he's one of the most rising stars. Plus, wherever conferences I've gone, the first name or the second name I always hear about Anant Agarwal. I knew about him, but didn't have the privilege So the next thing I thought, how do I get, you know, to this talent contest, because I'm outstanding in every direction, entrepreneur, and there are many of you here sitting, thinking of startups and other companies. So he is perhaps the best person with the best minds to sort of give you, you know, his talk on digital, you know, explosion in education, and that's very important. So let me sort of go through his Agarwal, but I don't want to take too much of time. Professor Anant Agarwal is the CEO of edX, an online learning destination founded by Harvard and MIT. Anant taught the first EDX courses on circuits and electronics from MIT, which drew 155,000 students from 162 countries. So this itself, I mean, you know, there's nothing more. He has served as the director of CSIL's MIT's Computer Science and AI Laboratory, and he's also a professor of electrical engineering and computer science at MIT. He is a successful serial entrepreneur, having founded several companies, including Telera Corporation, which created the Tile multi-core processor and virtual machine works. See, MIT is known for that. When we were students, at that time, the connection machine was quite popular by Daniel Hills, you know, who was at MIT and was a student. And so, Anant is one of the outstanding students, not only from there, from all around the world. And I have a good friend by name, Professor Zavi Galil at Georgia Tech, who is the dean of the School of Computing. During one of my conversations, I said, we are very fortunate to have a very distinguished faculty, Anant Agarwal. He said, Ram, I don't think there's anything better you can do than inviting. So this is the quality of caliber Professor Agarwal is. Professor Agarwal won many awards. I'm going to mention a few of them. Maurice Wilks Prize for Computer Architecture, and Excellence in, you know, Teaching, Jamison's Prize. He's also the 2016 recipient of Harold W. McGrew Jr. Prize for Higher Education, which recognized his work advancing the MOOC movement, perhaps most of you know. Additionally, he received the Padma Shri, which is the most coveted fourth prize from India, the fourth highest civilian order in the Republic of India. He holds a Guinness World of Record for largest microphone array, and is an author of the most famous, I thought I've written many textbooks. When I started looking at the Agarwals, I mean, these are some of the most famous textbooks, Foundations of Analog and Digital Electronic Circuits. Now, in this context, I also mention his professor, Professor Hennessy, was a professor professor of computer science. He's also the president of Stanford University. And Hennessy and David Patterson wrote a book when we were students, most famous book in computer architecture, and I'm sure hundreds of copies have been sold even today. So this is the kind of a caliber of what Professor Anant Agarwal, we are very fortunate to have him today. Now, Scientific American selected his work on organic computing as one of the 10 world's changing ideas in 2011. Most important thing. And he was named Forbes list of top 15 education innovators in 2012. Anant is a pioneer in computer architecture, and you know, everybody wants to be a member of the National Academy, and he is one of them at a very early age. You know, we may be trying later in our life, but he's a member of the most prestigious National Academy of Engineering, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and fellow of ACM, and there are many, many awards. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I don't think I can say anything, and it is a real fortunate to have somebody of this caliber, and you know, for us to come. And I was also telling you the quality of Professor Anant Agarwal. I was asking him, our foundation is going to pay you some money. He said, I don't need any money. You know, what a wonderful person. This is the most important thing, you know. Then the second thing is, he has just arrived from Boston this early morning. And so you can very well imagine he still may have some jet lag. And I think his schedule is very packed. But in any event, it is our honor to have us, you know, here at least for a brief time to talk about his experiences and to inspire many of you, these guys. You know, like as Professor Hardy said, I want to discover, when Professor Hardy was asked, what is your major discovery? You know, this, he was giving a talk in front of Harvard University in 1937. Then he said, ladies and gentlemen, I don't think I've done anything, but I've discovered one person by name Ramanujam. He is my discoverer. So we are also giving a book to all the award winners, a book titled, you know, An Apology from Hardy. And I think all of you should read at least the winners. So let's welcome, you know, with a jubilation, our distinguished visitor, Professor Anant Agarwal.
Thank you, sir, for introducing the keynote speaker. Now over to Dr. Anant Agarwal.
Well, the folks are making their way to the seats. I must remember to hire Dr. Iyengar as a marketing specialist. Well, what did they say about marketing? It's lies, damn lies, and more lies. But thank you for the very kind words. Let me start by congratulating the 15 winners, the awardees. And, you know, Dr. Iyengar talked about inspiration. It is not for me to inspire you, but for you to inspire us. So, again, congratulations. Also, all of you here from high school who are doing amazing things. Some people get recognized, but everybody is special. It's just you're still not discovered. It's only a matter of discovery. So again, ladies and gentlemen, I'm really, really delighted to be here, particularly in Bangalore. I grew up, I was born in Lucknow, which is why I have a name like Agarwal. But my parents came down to Bangalore when I was 6 months old, and so I lived all my life in Mangalore. So, you know, I love to, you know, I've come to Bangalore very often when I was in the 60s and 70s for various table tennis tournaments and so on. And I think we even came to National College once. And I remember Mangalore is very hot all the time. Is it anybody here from Mangalore? Good. Tuluvar Punde? you know, I still remember, Mangalore is hot all the time, and my one memory of Bangalore from those early days was, it was bitterly cold. And then I went to, I've been in the U.S. for almost 40 years, and I flew in from Boston yesterday. And in Boston yesterday, in centigrade, it was, we follow the stupid imperial system of the temperature, it was minus 10 degrees Fahrenheit. So what is it? Can one of you geniuses do a quick calculation? How much is it in centigrade? Yeah, so it's you know, around, you know, minus well in the minus column, and so it was very cold yesterday. It's very hot in India, so I feel like I'm at the two ends of a thermocouple. So you know what a thermocouple is, right? You know, one end is very cold, one end is very hot, and you produce electricity in the middle. So I hope I get that gives me the energy to talk. But again, I'm really delighted to be here. And also, thank you very much to the leadership here. It is absolutely fantastic to see visionaries like Dr. Iyengar and Dr. Baldev and others that are have the vision to think about recognizing children and students that have unique talents, that have great potential. And again, as I said, everybody has something unique about them, but recognition like this can be very important to stress that science and talent and doing well are very, very important for all children. So really, thank you all for, and thank you leadership of the Talent Search program for doing something like this. You know, growing up in India, there's not a whole lot. Although Bangalore is a fantastic place. I also remember coming to Bangalore to the Vishveshwarya Industrial and Technological Museum for the science fair. I remember I had a little science project from my St. Aloysius High School in Mangalore. And to me, Bangalore was the ultimate mecca for education and technology and so on. So all of those who are here, you are just so lucky, you know, compared to all the other places you could be. So in today's talk, I want to focus on education. My own research has been in fields like computer science and computer architecture and chip design and so on. But for the past 6 years, I've been involved with education. And education has not changed a whole lot in a long time. And we are very interested in transforming education. And to give you a sense of how terrible it is in education, let me ask you a quick question. So I want you to think back to, say, 500 years. So the last 500 years, I want you to yell out, what have been the biggest innovations in, pick some field, what about transportation? What have been the biggest innovations in transportation in the past 500 years? Internal combustion engine. I didn't hear. Steam engine. What else? In transportation.
Aircraft.
Turbo engines. What else? Self-driving cars. What else? How about platform technologies like Uber that can connect anybody with a car to anybody that has a car? What else? Rocket engines. Inertial guidance systems. Come on. What else? Bullet trains, exactly. Absolutely. So the list goes on and on. I can pick any field. Pick healthcare. What have been the biggest innovations in healthcare in the past 500 years? 500 years. Again, not just 100 years. 500 years. Heart transplantation. Antibiotics. Dialysis. Vaccination. Imagine, you know, anesthesia. Before anesthesia was invented, they hit you on the head with a hammer and did surgery on you before you came back to consciousness, right? I mean, so imagine, you know, the incredible innovations. Okay, now I want you to think about education. Tell me about the biggest innovations in education in the past 500 years. Now let's leave out the last few years. What have been the biggest innovations in the past 500 years? Nope. Printed books happened before 500 years. So the printing press was invented in the more than 500 years ago. So therefore, the printing press doesn't count. That's why I said 500 years. Yes, the printing press was that innovation. What else? Pardon? Telephone. I would say that's in communications. Yeah, it would be one of the big innovations in the communications field. But what about education? Pardon? Again, I'm trying to leave out the recent past. Pardon? That was a good one. That's a big one. Blackboard was a big one. Blackboards came out in 1860s. Was a big one. I want to tell you a joke about blackboard teaching. So whenever some big invention happens, all the practitioners of that hate it. You won't believe how much the professors at that time and instructors, we think we know a lot, but they hated the blackboard. You know why they hated the blackboard? Pardon? Chalk dust. No, they didn't understand allergies and so on in those days. People were very healthy, so not chalk dust. What were the reasons professors hated blackboards? Pardon? Change. No, yeah. People dislike change. So change, I agree. Change was an issue. But what else? They have to write by hand. I mean, they had no choice. I mean, they wrote by hand. Even books were written by hand, so no difference. It wasn't permanent. But that's good, because this way, if you make a mistake, you can quickly erase it. So as a professor, I love that. Pardon? Oh, not on the star. No, but that's okay. But I'm still, even when I write, they can still see the professor. So that's not. So what was the reason? Yes. Board is black. Now they even make green colored boards. So, and who said black has anything to do with the black is beautiful? Not for them, maybe. No, but that's not the reason. What is the reason? What do you say? You can still explain more detail with the blackboard. What was it? That's it. You got it. You got it. What's your name? Krishna Prasad Revankar got the answer. Come on, geniuses. You know, one of us professors got the answer. So the answer was that before blackboards, you looked at the class and you talked to the class. With blackboards, you stood and you wrote like this. So they were totally opposed to it because saying our backs are to the students. Although I do know some professors who can write like this. But that was the reason. But anyway, that joke was just to say that whenever big innovation has happened in a field, people have been opposed to it. But more fundamentally, you saw the silence in the room when I asked about innovation in education in 500 years. Besides the printing press and the blackboards, there really hasn't been any innovation along the lines of anesthesia or penicillin or vaccination. I mean, there's just nothing at that level. And so, and education is so fundamental. And I think it's time that we use technology to transform education. Technology has transformed every field known to mankind, but education has remained immune to technology. Maybe there's one more field that has remained immune to technology, like education. And I think that is politics and government. But anyway, let's leave that. I come from the US, and so I should not be talking about where we are today. But anyway. So let me ask you another question. So education needs to change. But let's also look at one big reason we educate people is to so they can learn for life, and also so they can go and work. So it's also useful to think about what is the future of work. What will the future of work look like? What will the future look like? So I want you to fast forward your minds to 2030. It's only 13 years from now, not very far. So by 2030, what percent of today's jobs you think will still be around by 2030? What percent of today's job will still be around in 2030? Because of artificial intelligence, automation, technology, and so on. What percent of jobs will still be around because of these technologies? 60% will be around. 20% will be around. You know, it's interesting. Some of the older people like me, we feel 60, 70% will be around. The younger people, I hear more like 10%, 20%. So younger folks, you are very optimistic, aren't you? So a lot of studies have shown that about half of today's jobs will be gone by 2030. Half jobs. Now people don't quite grasp it. What does it mean for half the jobs to be gone? To put that in perspective, remember, each time you shake hands with somebody, just think that by 2030, one of you won't be there. Half. So what does this mean? This simple statistics has very fundamental consequences for education and education institutions. National College, listen to me now. Things have to change. If half of today's jobs will be gone by 2030, in 13 years, imagine half of today's people who are working will not have a job. Now, they have to do something. So they have to be reskilled. The big buzzword in India, how many of you have heard the big buzzword, upskilling or reskilling? Not good. We need to fix that. Now you've all heard the word. How many people have heard about the word reskilling or upskilling? I just said it 5 seconds ago. Okay. Wake up. So the point is that if half the people are going to lose their jobs because of AI and automation, clearly we can't let them all lose their jobs. We have a planet-scale reskilling effort in front of us. Whether it's India or America or China, we need a massive reskilling and upskilling of people where we need to train them in new areas, in new jobs. In fact, even today, Some of the most cutting-edge jobs are in fields that were not invented more than 10 years ago. So I'll give you one example. How many of you have heard of the field of data science? Okay. So what is very interesting is that data science was a field invented less than 10 years ago. I remember when I was the director of the computer science and AI lab at MIT, we thought that, you know, all this thing we're doing with data and so on, we said, this field needs a name. And I remember some of my colleagues were arguing, should we call it big data? Should we call it data science? Now, I really disliked the name data science, which is what it became called. I really hated data science because nothing with science in it is really a science. Right? Physics does not have science in it. It's a real science. Biology doesn't have science in it. It's, in the word, it's a science. Chemistry doesn't have science in it. But computer science is not a science. Political science is not a science. Social science is not a science. But they called it data science. What do you do? But that said, data science was invented less than 10 years ago. And there's 3 million jobs in data science alone. Cybersecurity wasn't a problem and wasn't a field until about 15, 20 years ago. People did not know what machine learning was until 5 years ago. And now everybody you talk to cares about machine learning. You know what's going to be super hot 5 years from now? Quantum computing. Now, these are all new fields. And you didn't learn about this in the past. And data science wasn't a known field where you learned. And so the newer and newer jobs, the massive jobs are in these newer fields. And so whether it is because people will lose jobs or because the hot jobs are in these fields, it means that people will have to continually study and learn and reskill to be able to keep up with the pace of technology. So do you see what I'm getting at? So in today's world, learning all the time, not just learning once when you go to college, but learning throughout life will become very important as fields change. In the past, you went to college, so many of you are going to be going to college, or I hope that you will be smarter and invent something, start a company, and not go to these places called colleges. They're old-fashioned. I mean, they're still doing stuff that we did 300 years ago. Some of the most successful entrepreneurs got out of college early. Bill Gates, Zuckerberg, they did okay. We colleges need to change. We need to change our entire education system. Our system is built on the simple model that after PUC, after you're 17 or 18, you go to college for 4 years or 5 years, and then you go get a job. And that's it. And then you work for 20, 30, 40 years. We are close to ISRO and so on. In the missile terminology, it's called fire and forget. At the age of 18 to 24, you fire and then they're gone. But we need to move to a whole model of education where continuous learning becomes the rule of the day. Continuous lifelong learning. It's not enough to learn for 4 years. Because every 10 years, the whole fields are going to change. And if you think technology is moving fast, it will get even faster. And that's scary. So what we have to be teaching people in schools and colleges is not what to learn and the content for 4 years and then work for the rest of their life. They need to be learning how to learn. Our entire university system is completely broken. National College, you know, St. Aloysius College, where I went to. Anybody here from St. Aloysius College? But I went to school. It's an old model. Colleges where you learn once, and colleges don't have much to do with you after you get a master's degree and move on. Let's say you get a master's degree and move on, right? You're 23, you get a master's, you go to work. When you're 33, you want to get a job in data science, but you haven't learned data science. You have a family of 2 children. You have a little car. You have a little house. You have to make payments on your flat. How the heck are you going to go back to university where you're going to go back to IISc or go back to IIT or NIIT or IIIT? How are you going to go back to campus for 2 years to get another master's degree? You can't do that. So we need to change the whole system where universities have to change. You know, entire fields have completely changed, but universities haven't changed. If you look at Uber, that's completely transformed transportation. Netflix has transformed the entertainment industry. Airbnb and TripAdvisor have completely transformed the hospitality industry. You know, these platform technologies, in the space of 5 years, technology has completely transformed that industry. But education has not been touched. Our children have also completely changed. This is how people learn today. In the top left-hand corner, you see my daughter. Her name is Anisha. And I'll tell you a funny story about her. So when she became a teenager, when she turned 13, suddenly they stopped. In India, children are still very respectful to parents and everybody else. But in the U.S., they pretty much stopped talking to the parents. And I remember, I would go to a room to say, okay, come for dinner, and she'd be doing some online thing, and complete silence. Then I would say, Anisha. She would say, So they communicate in two syllables, silence and grunts, two things. I call it a digital language. But that's how they communicate today. It's all texting, tweeting, Snapchatting, WhatsApping. How many of you have heard of Snapchat? You know what's interesting is that all the hands in the back half of the auditorium has gone up, nothing in the front half. That's my point. I did not know what. So the way I began to communicate with my daughter is I picked up WhatsApp and I learned these things. So now when I text her, I get an instant response. My wife insists on calling her on the phone. She's now in first year in college. My wife insists that they should still learn to talk and so on. She would call her on the phone and she never picks up the phone. I text her, I get an instant response, and my wife gets really upset. So I said, you have to get with the program. You have to learn to communicate in the way that our modern generation is communicating. They are online 7/24. Doesn't matter what time of day. You text, you tweet. And can you imagine, grown people talking about tweeting? Yeah. I remember when I was in school, Tweety Bird was this little yellow bird that... And here you see grown men, presidents, tweeting and talking about tweeting. And it's okay. The online world has taken over, and that's how people learn. In fact, one day I was walking by her bedroom, and she was, I took that picture lying down like that, and she had three screens in front of her, a laptop, her a iPhone, and she'd stolen my mini iPad, and she was watching three screens. So, like an Indian parent, I said, I got really mad. I went and began yelling and saying, your mind is going to be mushed. How can you be doing three things at the same time and so on? And like only a daughter can say, she said, Dad, calm down. And then she said, on my laptop, I'm doing physics WebAssign problems. On my iPad, yes, I know she's watching YouTube. And on the smartphone, she says, I'm WhatsApping with my friends. And asking questions and helping each other. And I said, but your brain will go mush as you try to do all these things. She said, no, we know how to multiplex. Your generation can't. And I think to myself, how does she know the meaning of the word multiplex? Well, it's a whole different, I think the brains are wired differently. And so they're completely different. But our education systems are so totally different. We still bring students to a classroom, make them sit for 1 hour. I remember I would go to class, and for me, 5 minutes were the magic number. After 5 minutes, either the professor was going too fast for my brain, and I would not follow, in which case I would just stop understanding and just taking notes. How many of you have done that? Or the professor would be going so slow that I would be falling asleep. And so it's never the right pace. And for 1 hour, this would happen. And certainly when I went to IIT, most of the time, I saw all the people around me knew what was going on, and they were nodding their heads and all that stuff, and I had no idea what the professor was talking about. So I would just sit there feeling horrible, saying, am I the only dumb idiot in this class? And I would sit there copying notes. I had no idea what they were saying. Whatever they wrote on the blackboard, I wrote down in my book. That's it. They were going too fast for me. And so nothing is the right pace. And so why do we still do that with our children? So it turns out that technology can change all of that. Digital technology can completely transform, just like digital technology has transformed Uber, it can completely transform education. Now just imagine, before the days of Uber, so many of you are younger generation, Uber is normal. Oh, but forget Uber, let's talk about communications, talk about smartphones. Before the days of smartphones, it was nearly impossible to communicate with somebody. The phones sitting outside on the roads did not work. Where do you find a 50 paisa coin to put in the phone? It never worked anyway. There's no phone book, so how do I find a phone number? Life didn't work. Similarly with Uber, we just pull up an app and Uber shows up, you jump in. Calling a taxi was a nightmare. How many of you remember the days when you had to somehow get a taxi? Autos were okay. I still remember, I've come to IISc many times. There would be a little auto rickshaw stand outside IISc, so you could always get an auto. But I've been to other places like in Mount Road or other streets where you're standing there trying to catch an auto for 20, 30, 40 minutes. And then your auto would stop. And I said, I want to go to Malleshwaram. They said, oh, it's too far. It's crazy. But technology has changed all of that. With one click, you can get the Uber where you want it. Can we do the same thing for education? And today I'll talk about some of these ideas. So edX was formed 6 years ago. edX is a nonprofit. We don't take any VC money. We are completely nonprofit. And founded by Harvard and MIT. And our mission is very simple. We want to expand access to education for everybody. Education is a human right. Everybody should have access to education, just like the air we breathe. So today when you go home, you turn on the tap, you get water. You breathe in, you get oxygen. Education should be like that for everybody. It's a right. Everybody around the world should have access. And with technology, we can do that. You heard earlier about the circuits course that I taught, which had 155,000 students to take it. It was free. It was available online. And because all the grading and all the testing and certification, assessment, everything is online, done by cloud computing. It's very, very inexpensive. And so we did not have to limit the number of students. So why does IIT take only 1% of students who apply? Can you imagine that? Education is a right. Yet an IIT admits only 1 out of 100 students. It should be embarrassing to IITs. It should be embarrassing to our education systems. Why is it that the education system, universities that admit fewer people are considered better? What's wrong with that system? Just imagine this. The more a university excludes, the higher reputation it has. Do you follow me? Does it make any sense? MIT admits 7% of people who apply. And it's considered very highly reputable. Compared to a university that admits 1 in 2 students. It's completely broken. Education is right. Everybody should have access. And the reason IITs can't admit more than 1 out of 100 students is that the campus can't hold that many students. Every student gets a hostel spot, and you can't admit 10,000 students. You just can't. Can we use technology to change that? And in the circuits course, 155,000 students took it. 7,200 students passed an MIT course, completely online, this course. So at MIT, I teach about 200 students a year in circuits. So I would have to teach at MIT for 35 years before I could teach as many students as I taught in one class, in one semester, online. The number of students that passed. Remember, 155,000 were the students who took the class and 7,200 passed it. So with technology, we can change the whole access equation completely. Second, we also want to reimagine education. We want to increase education and quality. We want to improve education and really reimagine education for this whole new world of education where continuous lifelong education needs to be the norm for universities. So the way we work is, as a nonprofit, we partner with some of the best institutions in the world, like Harvard, MIT, Oxford, IIM Bangalore is a partner, IIT Bombay is a partner, Tsinghua in China is a partner. These content providers create courses on edX, and students all over the world take these courses. It's like Uber. So we are a platform company. Uber is a platform company. It connects people who have cars with people who want a ride, and they take a small fee in the middle. With edX, it's different. We connect people who have content to people who want the content for free. That is what edX, it's a platform company. So today, a few words about edX. Over the 6 years since we've been founded, today we have, the slide is a little old, we have almost 15 million students. What is that? 150 lakh students from every single country in the world, 196 countries. We have about 2,000 courses or more on the platform, 130 partners on our platform. We have students from the age of 7 years all the way to grandparents of 95 years old taking courses on our platform. So if you haven't tried it out, I would encourage you, you can go and learn for free. We're a nonprofit. Go to edX.org, edX.org. And there's a app for your Android or iPhone. Download the app or your iPad, and you can be learning for free. Just go to Google and search. Let's say you want to learn about soft skills. Type in soft skills course. Usually the edX course will appear at the top of Google search. Just go take the course, and it's free. Now, in case you ask, how do we stay in business? Even nonprofits have to eat. So what we do is that you can learn for free, but we charge a small amount of money for certification. And that's how we sustain enterprise. Here are some of the learners on edX. They come from all parts of the world. In fact, in the middle there, right in the middle, you see Akshay Kulkarni, and an interesting story from Bangalore. I was at Bangalore airport 2 years ago, and I just checked in my bags and was coming out when I see this young kid with about 15 other kids around him walk up to me and said, "Are you Anant Agarwal?" And I said, "No, no. If you're in not in your usual country, and 20 people come at you and surround you, and someone asks, you know, are you Krishnamurti or something, you're going to be scared." And so I said, I wasn't sure if I should say yes or no. And then I said, yes, but I don't think I did anything wrong. I have my passport and so on. They said, no, we are taking your courses. And so we are very grateful for all the work that you and your partner universities are doing. So so this just one story about this guy. So this guy was from a small engineering college and not any big name college. He was looking for a job. And he's a very, very bright kid. And he did computer science courses from MIT. On edX, and then he did courses on software as a service in cloud computing from Berkeley on edX. He applied to Microsoft in Hyderabad for a job, and they're looking at this kid from this small engineering college, and on his resume, it says he has completed courses from Berkeley successfully in software as a service. And they asked him two or three questions, and he knew those answers cold. They said, we won't even have to train you. And they hired him on the spot. And so there are many, many stories of learners. In fact, 43% of the students who earned certificates in career-focused courses are telling us that they've achieved a promotion or a career advancement because of these course certificates, either a pay raise or a promotion or a new job. 47% are posting the certificates on LinkedIn. That's very important for all of you aspiring folks. Create a LinkedIn profile. And how many of you have a LinkedIn profile? Again, all the people in the back. I have one too. And I just got mine recently. So get the LinkedIn profile. That's how you build your persona. Put your certificates there. Each edX certificate, with one click you can post your edX certificate on LinkedIn. So do that. So I talked about lifelong learning. So how can we use technology to transform education? So one example that I gave you was using online learning and online technologies, technology-enabled learning, to enable hundreds of thousands of students to take courses. As I mentioned, we have 15 million students on edX learning. The circuits course had 155,000 students. We have an introduction to computer science course from Harvard that has more than 1 million students taking it. Imagine having 1 million classmates from every country in the world. And the way these, I'll give you an example of how learning works, but if you have a doubt or a question, there is an online discussion forum. How many of you have been on an online discussion forum like Reddit or Quora or Facebook? So a lot of you have been on online discussion forums. How many of you have used a discussion forum in your university for university learning? Isn't that crazy? All of you are using all these technologies for social stuff to ask, hey, where shall we go to, which cafe shall we go tonight? But you're not discussing education. So what we are doing is applying cloud computing, mobile computing, gamification, AI, all the hot technologies to learning and completely change the way learning works. And we can increase it in scale, so we don't have to have admissions anymore. So we can create new forms of education where everybody is welcome. Now, wouldn't that be cool? For all of you people in high schools, wouldn't that be cool if you did not have to worry about where you went to college? You are automatically admitted? I remember when I was in PUC, 11th standard, the biggest thing on my mind was, I wanted to do engineering. The biggest thing on my mind was, how do I get admission into a college? I wasn't worrying about my classes, I was worried about entrance exams. Why did they have entrance exams? If education is right, shouldn't everybody get it? I mean, just imagine, before you can take a breath to breathe oxygen, if they give you a test to say, okay, write this test. If you succeed, you can take a breath. We don't do that. For water, before you turn the tap on, oh, here's a 10 question multiple choice. If you get everything right, you can drink some water. You don't do that. But for education, we make you do that. It's stupid. With technology, we can make it accessible to everybody. Everybody can come and have access to education. And I'll give you examples of how we've done that. What about lifelong learning? So let's say you've completed the education and you're in a company. How do you keep learning in data science and AI and cybersecurity and big data, project management, digital product management, digital leadership, all these hot topics? How do you learn about these? You can't go back to university. So how do you keep learning? You can do it online. So if it's online, you can learn on your own time. But what about credentials? So it's US is not as much, but in India, parchi is king, right? You need a parchi. You need a certificate. In India, we don't do anything unless we get something, like a certificate at least, right? But for lifelong learning, there's no concept of if I learn something, I don't get anything. So what we've done is we've also innovated in credentials. So we've launched a new credential called the MicroMasters. Remember, we had mainframe computers and then we had microprocessors? Similarly, there's Masters, which is like the mainframe. The MicroMasters is a new credential. It's about 25% of the volume of a master's degree, of the content. But this is completely open admissions. You don't have to apply. No JEE, GRE, none of that stuff. No GMAT, no SATs. Everybody's welcome to take it. You can join for free. So you can download the edX app or go to the edX website and say, I want to learn this MicroMasters. Just start learning. Did I tell you the courses are free? You just start learning. And we can take any number of students. There's no admissions. You want to learn artificial intelligence from Columbia? Just go start learning. You want to learn supply chain management from MIT? Start learning. Digital marketing or marketing analytics from Berkeley? Do it. You want to learn, get a mini MBA from IIM Bangalore? Go to edX. There's 6 courses in business. It's about 25% of a master's degree. And you can learn for free. And technology can enable all of these things. The MicroMasters is fully online. And you want the credential. It's about $1,000, so it's about 60,000 rupees if you want the MicroMasters credential. And we also offer financial aid for those who can't afford even the 60,000 rupees for the MicroMasters. We'll even give you financial aid so you can pay very little for that. And then if you complete it, for people who are working, this is a new digital 21st century credential. You can collect MicroMasters. You can get 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 MicroMasters and collect them. And then if you get admission, let's say you do a MIT MicroMasters in Supply Chain Management, and you get admission into MIT, and you want to do the Masters at MIT, you can apply the credits from the MicroMasters towards a Master's degree. You don't have to pay that tuition. You can accelerate your degree. But you may not want to do a full Master's degree. You can maybe just stop with the MicroMasters. So the beauty of these is that these are also being endorsed by companies. So the MicroMasters in Artificial Intelligence is endorsed by GE. So corporates are saying that these are important programs. So just to give you a quick little story, Mia Radish is one of our students, and she had a job. So she completed the MIT MicroMasters in Supply Chain Management. And she put that on her LinkedIn profile. She got an interview call from Akamai. How many of you have heard of this company, Akamai? They do caching of web traffic and so on. She got a job there in Supply Chain Management and doubled her salary. Many, many, many stories of young people like that. In fact, many companies have begun to recognize it. And this character you see up there on the top right-hand corner is Charlie Baker, the governor of Massachusetts. He's like the chief minister. And he made an announcement with GE, where GE has said that they will guarantee an interview for any candidate in Massachusetts who completes a MicroMasters in AI, cybersecurity, supply chain management, or cloud computing. And the reason is, these are hot new topics. They can't find enough people with these skills because universities are still teaching old stuff. And so they're looking for people in this hot new field, and they can't even find the people. So now they're guaranteeing an interview to people that complete the MicroMasters in these topics. In Bangalore, I met several companies today, and at least two of them are interested in making similar commitments that you complete this, I will guarantee you an interview. And it doesn't matter what your background is. Doesn't matter which country you're from, which language you speak, what your ethnicity, your caste, your creed, your... They don't even care what college you came from. They don't even care what marks you got in college. Nothing. If you do well here in this program, I will give you an interview. And there's no admissions here. And this is very important because oftentimes, these admissions tests... So how many of you have heard of the SAT? A Scholastic Aptitude Test. That's SAT is a test that every high schooler in the U.S. takes to get admission into college. It's like a JEE in India. It's SATs in the U.S. You'll be shocked to learn that there is a one-to-one correlation between your parents' income and your performance in the SAT. Can you believe that? That is, SAT scores correlate very heavily with your family income. And there are many reasons for that. The people who are well off can afford coaching classes. People can go to, they can spend a lot of money, go to expensive schools. And so our focus on edX is we want to democratize education. We want to make access to education available to everybody, irrespective of how much their family earns, from which country they come from, what their background is. Everybody should have access and really level the playing field. And technology can do that. Just like anybody can go and watch a YouTube video, we want everybody to be able to get an education. And we can use technology to do that. EdX has also made our platform. So we built a platform as a nonprofit. We've given away our platform for free to the world as well. Anybody, you can go to GitHub and download our software platform and launch your own edX. It's free. We're giving away all software. It's like Google saying that we're going to give away a search algorithm, so any company can launch a search site using our software. For-profit companies will never do that. What are the odds that Uber would give away their software platform so any company can launch a Uber using exactly their software? Only non-profits will do stupid things like that, right? Give away stuff for free. So we've given it away. And so many education ministries of countries have adopted it. Russia has launched a site called openedu.ru based on our software. China, France has launched France Université Numérique. Israel has launched one. Saudi, Hong Kong. So about 15 to 20 countries have launched national infrastructures using open source software from edX. So the last few minutes, I want to talk a little bit about how we can improve education and quality using technology. So far I've talked about how technology can be used to increase access to education by having open enrollments. I've talked about how we can create new credentials to enable people to learn throughout life. But can we improve education and quality? So let me give you a simple example. I don't think you can see it very clearly. So I want you to go to edX.org and try this out for yourself. Did I tell you it's free? So you'll see a site like this. And instead of a one-hour lecture, we have a sequence of activities. Okay, so it's an interleaved sequence of activities. How many of you have watched YouTube? I'm impressed. Even the front seats, a lot of hands went up, which is great. So it's a learning sequence. It's an interleaved sequence of short YouTube-like videos, 5-10 minute videos, interleaved with interactive exercises. You're shown a video. It's like a little mini lecture, and then you're asked a question. And you engage your brain and your thinking and you're answering questions based on that. And this model of learning where you're interleaving videos and exercises is called active learning. You're not just learning, it's called active learning. And this form of learning where you are interleaving content and interaction is provably better than just the content transfer approach, where... So here's just one example of a study. It's hard to see the data, but you can see the bars. The right-hand bar is the post-test success for students who'd been taught using the active learning method. And the first bar is those people who got the videos alone. So it shows that people simply learn better when you have these newer models of learning. And so with online techniques, we can do that. There are many other, how many of you here has taken any online course so far? You know what is interesting? Huge bunch of them. So are the 15 people concentrated there? Or yeah. It's interesting that virtually every hand went up there. So some of the benefits of online learning, one is active learning. Second is instant feedback. Instant feedback says when I submit an answer to a question, the grading is done by computer. I get whether I got it right or wrong immediately. This brings an element of gamification. Now just imagine in your mind what we're putting up with our existing education system. So in IIT, I would turn in a homework, and I got back the graded homework 2 weeks later. How many of you have played a video game? So if in a video game, let's say you're playing a video game with Mario Brothers or something, right? And you clicked jump, right? And you click jump. Or let's do a simpler thing. You had a gun and you shot at a target. You shot, and the video game said, okay, come back in 2 weeks and I'll tell you if you hit your target. How successful do you think the video game would be? Would you be engaged at all? It's you'll go away. It's not interesting if you don't get instant feedback. But with online learning, because with cloud computing, I can grade all the assessments and labs and everything else completely online, I can get instant feedback. So I know when something is right or wrong. In fact, I'll tell you a story. In the first circuits course that I taught on edX, we had a green check mark for when something was right and a red X when something was wrong. And one student said that, and this was common across many students. One student said that I would go to bed at night dreaming of the green check mark. When's the last time as a professor, when's the last time your students have dreamt of doing homework? Students could not put down their homework because it became like a game. They had to get it right. They would keep trying and you get multiple tries. With homework, you get one try, like today. Exams, you get one try. And you make a silly mistake, you're dead. How many of you have been trapped by a silly mistake in an exam? Everybody. Oh, come on, professors. When we were young, we've also been trapped by silly mistakes, right? How many of you made a silly mistake in an exam and you got a problem wrong? 2 + 2 is, you made a mistake and you just silly. So why, with computers, you can give people multiple chances. And you can catch silly mistakes, at least. And then things like this are things that technology can completely correct, and we should totally do that. There are many, many, and with the electronic technology, we can do all kinds of computing, not just and all kinds of grading, not just multiple choice. We can grade very, very rich problem types. People also say, oh, but there's a lot of cheating going on in online. But no, we have virtual proctoring. We can use the camera. We use the camera to watch the student. And that video is recorded and shipped offline and watched later. So it's like outsourcing proctoring. Big business for India in the future. To watch those offshore videos for all of these proctored exams around the world. Today on edX, we gave an exam the other day for MIT supply chain program where 5,000 students around the world took the exam simultaneously and they were virtually proctored. So we can virtually proctor hundreds of thousands of students, no problem. Can you imagine bringing them to a classroom and proctoring 5,000 students? You can't do that. So in the last few minutes, I want to talk about where do I see education going in the future? And as universities, what should we be thinking about in the next 5, 10, 15 years, if we want to be relevant in the future? Because frankly, if as universities and education systems, if we don't change, we will be Uberized. So just like the yellow taxis and so on got Uberized, similarly, education's our system will be completely taken over by other technologies. So I see three important trends. I see omnichannel education, modular education, and lifelong education. Three trends: modular, lifelong, omnichannel. What's omnichannel? Omnichannel says that universities will have to move to both online and in-person teaching, both. You know, just like I can have omnichannel shopping, I can shop online if I want to. So how many people here have shopped online through Snapdeal? A lot of people have shopped online. How many people have gone to a store and bought stuff in person? That's omnichannel. Modular means that we divide education into smaller chunks. And lifelong means an education system where you can learn throughout life. So with modular education, as one example, instead of a full master's degree, you can get a piece of it. That's a micromaster's. In fact, we've launched a full online master's degree in analytics with Georgia Tech, where you can get the full master's degree for about $10,000, or you can get a piece of it called the micromasters. That's the benefit of modularity. You can stack it up. The other thing we've done is with modularity, you can share. Why should all your learning come from IISc? Or why should all your learning come from National College? Why should all your learning come from NIIT Suratgal? Why can't we mix and match? So today, you know, I might wear shoes from Bata, and I might get a shirt from CD or some other place. Imagine if I had to go to one store and buy everything from that store. If I had a great shirt but horrible shoes, I'm stuck. But with education, that's the system today, right? But with modular education, with modules, I can stack things up. I'll give you an example. So the IT university in Pakistan, very innovative university, what they've done is they had a master's in computer science and they wanted to launch a master's in data science, but they did not have the data science content. And so what they did was they have 7 courses for the computer science. They took out 3 courses and they plugged in a micromaster's in data science from edX, from University of California, San Diego. They plugged that in. And so now a student can get a data science degree at IT University in Pakistan, where a piece of the learning is completely on edX. So now it's like saying, I can now mix and match. And in the future, I see entire degrees where people will be able to mix and match. Hey, National College is really good at economics, I'm going to get economics from National College. IISc is fantastic at material science, I'm going to get material science from IISc. And mix and match and stack things up and create stacked, customized degrees through modularity. Omnichannel, even Amazon, the online giant, acquired Whole Foods. Whole Foods is bricks and mortar retailer. Really show that even in retail, omnichannel is going to be the key. And the same thing in education, omnichannel is going to be very important. So I'll give you one example of omnichannel. Omnichannel can be online before you come to campus, online during campus, or online after campus. I'll just highlight one, online before campus. So at edX, we partnered with Arizona State University on Global Freshman Academy, where an entire first year's worth of content is on edX. You can do that completely online. And you can learn for free. And the beauty of this is that you pay if you pass. You pay for credit if you pass. So you can take the courses, and if you pass, you can pay for credit. And then if you go to Arizona State, you can do your years 2, 3, 4 there. So you can complete a degree with a piece online, a piece on campus. So that's one example of omnichannel. And then finally, let me talk about a lifelong education. And here, just the example of the MicroMasters, where it's a new credential for lifelong learning, where corporations are endorsing it, and companies like GE are committing to hiring people who complete these programs are just examples of lifelong learning and creating ecosystems for lifelong learning. So with these modular, omnichannel, lifelong, I think it's really important for universities to be thinking about these approaches. And for students, I think the future is very bright. And as you think about your own education, think not just about, well, I'm going to get into a university. Think about really learning how to learn online. That would be a critical skill going ahead. And you know, just like taking an Uber is like a critical skill once you go to once you work. Similarly, learning online will be very, very important as continuous lifelong learning will become the rule of the day for the future of work. So with that, let me stop, and I'd be happy to take a couple of questions if there are. Thank you. Yes.
How extensive are the assessments that you in edX are the only summative or throughout the course?
So the assessments are both formative and summative. The question was, are the assessments throughout the course or only at the end? So with active learning, the assessments have to be formative. They have to be completely interleaved. So there is a video and then there's an assessment following that. So and the assessment types are very rich. We can do labs, there are, of course, multiple choice equations. We can do chemical equations. There's a solid state chemistry course on edX from Michael Seema at MIT where there's chemical equations and you can grade those. And then there's, of course, the summative exams at the end as well. And so you can mix just like in a regular course. And technology has come very far. We can do quite a lot online today. Yes.
Well, I think it's I think certainly the cost is more a business issue, or how much you sell it at is a business issue. But technology standpoint can be made accessible to anybody, and as technologists, that's the plan. And then with edX, what we say is, in order for us to be sustainable, we are going to charge for the certificates a modest fee. We've also launched a business to business, where we do corporate training. I mean, corporations are signing up for these programs in bulk. And in fact, there'll be a big announcement that we will be making with some pretty big Indian corporation on January 9th to talk about skilling entire workforces and reskilling entire workforces of companies. So we have multiple sources of revenue, but really I would keep this access part and the revenue part as two separate things, and you can decide how you want to manage either. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Sure. So Professor Iyengar talks about Khan Academy. So Salman Khan, the founder of Khan Academy, where you can learn math and other subjects. So he was my student at MIT, actually. And so one of my star students in the about 17 years ago. And I didn't even remember that. He'd come to MIT and I was chatting with him. And he saw me in the audience. He came up to me and said, "Oh, hello, Professor Agarwal." I said, "How do you know me?" He said, "I took your class." And when your class has 200 students, how do you remember every student? But so he's a real pioneer. So he really pioneered the concept of these videos, which are handwritten on a tablet. And I was very inspired by those videos myself. In my entire circuits course, I used those Khan style videos. So Khan Academy is a very good place to go learn mathematics and other subjects at the high school level in particular. What he doesn't have is certification or alternatives to education system. So it's more an adjunct, more a help kind of a resource. But certainly very inspirational. Yes?
So how do you plan to extend your platform to low network coverage areas or very rural areas?
That's a great question. The question was, how do you plan to extend your the platform to low coverage rural areas? Remember, first of all, we live on mobile. And so you'd be surprised to know that in India, I think in the next 2 or 3 years, 1 in 2 people will have a mobile device. And so that's a lot. And in Africa, it turns out that 1 in 10 people has access to a bricks and mortar college, but 1 in 2 has access to a mobile device. And so my view is that if we can at least make education accessible to all of the people who have access to the internet, we still have solved a big problem. And by that time, the internet will be available to everybody. With that said, there are some nonprofits who are also taking the edX platform, and they have made it available in a box in low bandwidth villages and so on. But certainly, you know, our focus has been on really building out a platform that can be used in multiple places. Thank you.
Now the core event. The core event is to present the awards to our inspired students. I call up the names. Professor Anant Agarwal will present the certificate and awards to the children. Abhinand P.S., JSS College School, Shivapuram, Kongor, Kerala. Bhuvana S., Vijaya Composite PU College, Bangalore. Charitra A., Mount Carmel PU College, Bangalore. Deepshika Basu, Sophia High School, Bangalore. Mahesh Bhaskar Egde, MES Chaitanya PU College, Uttarakhand. Neha H., St. Mary's PU College for Women, Bangalore. Prachi Shenoy B., Karkala Jnanasudha PU College, Udupi. Prachi Shenoy, Karkala Jnanasudha PU College, Udupi. Pramata Gajanan Bhatt, Alvas PU College, Mudbidri. Mudbidri.
Ravina Hebbar, Vidya Jyoti College, Kola. Reshma Ram, Sri Vidya Mandir PU College, Bangalore. Rishabh Prakash Kulkarni, SDR PU College of Science, Kalaburgi. Somshekhar M, National College, Bangalore. Saukya Rajaram Egde, MES Chaitanya PU College, Uttar Kannada. Spurti D. Nade, Christ Junior College, Bangalore. Varshit Gopal Krishna Bhatt, MES PU College, Sirsi, Uttarakhand. Thank you, sir. I request all the awardees to come for a group photograph. May I request Dr. Maya, one of the most celebrated entrepreneurs of Bangalore, MTR, in the Madras Academy, and he is well known internationally for his food quality and technology in developing fast food. Over to you, Dr. Maya.
Thank you and good evening, everybody. Probably I think I was the only one non-teaching staff. Am I correct? No. I have actually honorary professor from two universities. One is IIM Bangalore and another is Turku University. Both the places I had actually given the lectures continuously for almost about 3 years. I will speak 2 minutes in Kannada. I think we can have to understand Kannada. When my guru started, I think in somewhere in 55 to 60, I had a guru. In Kannada, I think what he said is, "Huttu aga hesirirudilla, usirirtade." ಸಾಯುವಾಗ ಉಸಿರಿರೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಹೆಸರಿರ್ತದೆ. ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಟೆಲ್ ಯು ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಐ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಟು ಯು ಸೀನ್ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕೇಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ವಾಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಲೀವ್ ಫಾರ್ ಎ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ ಪರ್ಪಸ್. ಸೊ ವೆನ್ ವಿ ಕಮ್ ಟು ದ ವರ್ಡ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಯು ಶುಡ್ ಡೂ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ವಿಚ್ ಈಸ್ ಅನ್ಫರ್ಗೆಟಬಲ್, ದೆನ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಪೀಪಲ್ ವಿಲ್ ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್. ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಹಿಮ್, he got the Grammy Award. So people will recognize, just like I think all these people who are sitting in the dais, that different are different jobs. People are asking me, I think, how do you identify the projects? See, for example, I think I have completed almost about 17 projects in my lifetime of 50 years. I will tell you a question now. I think the answer for that is actually, how do you get ideas? Have anybody noticed actually, the steps, number of steps here is 6, there it is 5. Has anybody observed this? You can see this, this is 6, that is 5. I had observed this. Just like that, I think I had lot of other observations. I think I had gone to different places in the world, not only in America and other places. I think most of the places, actually, I think I was in Taiwan for a very long time. One of my experiences, I will tell you, I think this is the best experience I think I can tell you. I had gone for a different purpose. See, we had gone for what is called, I think, let us come to 2018 now from 2030. I think he had taken to 2030, we will let us come back to 2018 now. About 10 years back, I think it is somewhere in 2006-2007, I went to Taiwan for making a Voda machine. He said, actually, I think people will lose the jobs in 2030. I will tell you in the other way. In 2030, we won't get skilled workers at all. It's the reverse of what we have. So I should have technology for making that. So I started somewhere in 2006. I went there. First, actually, I think I showed them, they didn't know what is Voda. I showed them how to make Voda by my mix first. Then I said, actually, what is Urundal? Then how to make Voda in a machine, I explained him. I made a pipe, stainless steel pipe, cut the pipe. Then I put actually to make the central hole, I make a central the block and welded it. Then again, I welded it. It is used like a pitchkari, I think we have used that piston kind of things and we pushed it. I said, my problem is I can do all these things through an auger filler. But my problem is to cut this because this doesn't have consistency. So it was we spent about 2 years. I could not find the solution. 2009 actually we found the solution. We made the machine. Myself and a Taiwanese doesn't know English, I don't know Taiwanese. We both made the machine. And the machine was ready. The other problem was actually something different. I think when we make by hand, suppose the Voda is some consistency, or you can say crispness, or oil consumption, or so many things. But if we make in the machine, same machine, it was not the same consistency. We took almost about, you can say, 6 years. That is in 2016, I found the solution for that. What was the problem? Researchers actually, I think, the young people like these people who are sitting, they should think all these things. See, it is a very, very, according to me, a common solution, but nobody has thought that. See, when we found actually, when you grind by hand, Voda will be perfect. When we grind by actually wet grinder, texture was completely different. When we grind by mixer, it is completely different. Then finally, our physics guru, Ram Rao, came to picture. We thought that I think I will take his help. Physics, actually, I think he taught me in 1964. Bulk density we have calculated. By grinding by hand, it was 0.4. By wet grinder, it is 0.8. And mixer, it is 1.2. Can anybody can understand? Bulk density, specific gravity. That was actually a clue for me to have the solution for that. We made the solution. Now today, we made the machine working, which gives actually better than actually what we make. Second, by this time I can think we had made actually one more innovation. That is actually, I think I had written the paper about this. I'm again giving for one more PhD for this technology. Plus, this is for the first time in the world. We are making actually what is called as the Urundal, that is black gram dal. When you grind it, without fermentation, I make idlis. So the first time in the world, I think I had given the papers to one of my friend in USA. He said something because which is needed for actually USA and other countries where actually the temperature is, you can see what he said, minus 10 or minus 20 or minus 30, because my daughter stays in Canada. She said, no, it is minus 28 now yesterday. So those kind of places, actually, when the fermentation is not at all possible, I can give actually without fermentation this kind of idlis or whatever you want with grinding. This is actually, I think, what we should think is actually in the future, what is useful for the mankind, we should think of making research. See, I had actually think one big experience in, say for example, in 2008 or 9, I think, I can't remember. I just actually came out of MTR. I sold the company. I was free for about 6 months. I was doing my PhD in Columbia University. So I came for actually vacation for about two weeks or 3 weeks. So then I came actually, I think the ITC, one of my friend was actually the CEO at that time in food division. He called me, can you give, we have 60 PhD scientists. Can you give a lecture actually to those people, I think, what they are doing? So then I had gone there. First question what I asked is actually, how many people have done new products? Out of 60, 30 people, 31 or 32 people said, they we have done with this, made this. Finally, I said that I think how much of actually these things will come to the market. There was no reaction. Everybody said it is, I don't know whether it will come to the market or not. Out of 17 products, actually, I think 17 technologies or 17 theories or whatever you say for me, all the 17 has come to the market. This is exactly what I am telling for the new innovators sitting here. In future, I think you should think of what he said. Think of future, 2030. 2030, everything will change except people eating by hand. That will not change, either by hand or spoon or a thing. So roti, kapda or makana, these three things I think will not go away, whether it is actually the robot will come or whatever you may say, it will not happen. So we have to eat. So let us hope that I think in the future, I think this might be, see, for example, I think I'm an engineer. By qualification, I'm an electrical engineer. What I'm doing is actually a food business. And I'm actually the innovation, I think what I have done for almost, what you can say, 17 items are completely different from what I learned. So that means actually what you learn is different, what you do is different. But you have to choose your. Thank you very much.
Friends, gifted means divine, I told in the beginning. I didn't said that it is also opportunity. Just about 1.5 hour back, an academician who was my friend, who became my younger brother, who became dear to me, he walked in and said, what you are doing, Baldev, today? I said, in the evening we have gifted children program. I said, what is gifted and all? We had a chat. And I know him. He inspires young people. He loves young people. He has transformed young people, just like he has transformed his basic science to technology. He has a huge biodata, search for Google. Dr. Anant Agarwal talked a lot about online and see him, that what he has done. But what I want you to experience, this wonderful person, academician, who transforms his applications to make a difference to the citizens, which is very dear to all of us. So Suresh, you are here on this stage, and then you please address these gifted children, their parents, and all of us.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I think so kind of you, Dr. Baldev Raj, and I'm a privilege to be his younger brother, as he said. The brother is not mean by that you are born in the same family. We are all in the same family, and that is India. I left this country about a long time ago. Only physically, mind is always here. Always with you. And that's why I keep coming, so I keep doing the work. I have a privilege to be a board of Aditya Birla Groups. I work with Tata Innovations. As Baldev Raj says, yes, I'm an innovator. I'm known in the world as innovators for different companies. Either it's a BHP Billitons or Rio Tinto or different. But I live my own lives different ways. But when Dr. Baldev Raj told me that this symposium for a gifted children's, then I told him, can I speak to the future of this country? Because I believe that you are the future of the country. The only difference is The only difference is if you believe in it. My message to you, that you believe in yourself. When I left India at the age of 25, 27 to England, England to Australia, I live in Down Under now for the last 34 years, isn't there? But I keep coming India for the last 10 years, 15 years, isn't there? I'm different advisory boards and I'm close to Dr. Ra, Dr. Sina Rav, so I'm still the guest of him, isn't here today. But I can tell you one thing, here, the life is still exists here. If the world has any life left, because the reason is that, I was talking about that is today with Dr. A.K. Sood, just I'm coming from his office, that what is the difference? The difference here is that there are so many problems, but there is a solution. The problems always comes with opportunities, right? And when the opportunity comes, what happens? You become very happy. The life come back. Go on the road, the traffic. But if you pass the traffic, if your car goes in there and you go through, there is a smile on the face, isn't it? I did it. Right? You can't get bored. And in my country, yes, the living is there. You drive Mercedes or BMWs or some things. You wear the clothes or don't wear the clothes. It doesn't matter. Right? Here you wear the clothes. If you have a suit, your neighbors will say, wow. And that's why I'm telling you the meaning of real innovations. If you want to see the difference, what difference makes the innovation is, if somebody says you do something, you show something, and somebody says only one single word, wow, that means, that's it. Market is attracted. The market decides the innovation. Academics often, I am one of them. I'm a professor for the last 37 years. I'm a full professor, is there too. Laureate professor, distinguished professor, whatever we call. But we forget to differentiate between the creativity and innovation. Innovation, what the people can see. You go to Japan, there is an umbrella, black and white. It sees, it covers the sunlight, it covers the rainings and everything else. But in Japan, they change the color of the fabrics. They change your umbrella into the pocket. They change electronics in the umbrella, rods in there too. Isn't there too? They may change in the light, in the bulbs inside the umbrella as well. You don't have to do much research. The time has come that you kill orthodoxies. Don't have to do the research on the same formula, same subject, what you learn in your PhD, then you do a PDF, same topic, you're refining, you're addressing the same problems different ways. No. My appeal to you, this country hasn't got much infrastructures. It's a country of the limited resources. We have to use every penny of it. And that's why you always look the missing piece of the puzzle. The puzzles has been solved. Different pieces of the puzzles are available in the literature. Collect them. And then find them to translate this research into the real world application. What is the missing piece? Work on that. You don't have to do, don't be proud that you have to publish a paper in Nature or Science or somebody great journals. Be proud of that. You convert it $1 to $3. You make the life easier. You translate the things into the things which on public, ordinary person can see it. Yes, it is useful to me. Your country can see, yes, it is useful to me. And the guys, I can tell you, the young generation can do it. We are oldies. We have done our bit. I'm saying that is not the fault of education. The education was wrong in the past or education is falling today. What I'm telling you, the education will be different in 21st century tomorrow. Do you know that 200 apps are downloaded per second? Per second. 4.6 billion per month. Apple alone invests about $9 billion per month on application apps. Tomorrow is different. You live in the world. You are connected. There was a time when we were not connected. This is the time we are very well connected. In Bangalore, this state alone, there is a spin-off one company startup per day. 365 startup. How many comes to the real world? Don't know. Maybe 10%, maybe 1%, maybe 2%. But there is a culture there. Culture of innovation, culture of translation research into the real product is there. I have a barrister friend here, which always talk to me that, can we do it? Can I help these guys? I'll help these guys. So guys, this culture must be sustained and maintained. I finished the talk, simple talks in there, that I was a follower from my childhood, the Swami Vivekananda. I never forget one of his phrases, he says, this life is a great chance. Seek for the highest, aim for the highest, and you will get the highest. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh Bhagwa, for your wonderful presentation. Now I call upon a few students to share their experience. And first, Abhinan P.S. Each one of them will get 1 minute, and four students will come onto the stage and they will speak for 1 minute.
A warm good evening to one and all, the respected dignitaries on and off the dais, and my dear friends. I think this is one of the unforgettable occasions in my life, because 3 months before, there is an accident happened in my life. Our class have a WhatsApp group, and that time is the midterm exam time. My physics teacher take the class of electromagnetism very fastly, very much fast. And one night, I'm chatting with my friend in the group. I just said that I can't understand what the teacher said, and I didn't take it as a serious chapter. I just forgot that the WhatsApp group is including my teacher also. Just 3 minutes after that, I have a personal message from my teacher. It's a video. I just opened it. It's a video from EDX. The video is about taken by Walter Levin, lecture on electromagnetism. It's a fantastic lecture. And I just asked the teacher, where do you get this? He just answered me that, you don't heard about the EDX. It's an online platform for children like you to take classes, and you can enjoy it. Before that, I take classes on Gyan Academy. There is in India, there is NPTEL is there, National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, and Coursera is also there. But EDX is entirely different, because the system which you follow is exactly perfect. I congratulate you for implementing such a thing for the world. I did 2 courses on EDX. One is the pre-university calculus, and another one is the quantum mechanics for everybody. Both of them are very, very much interesting. And what I say, I don't know what I want to say, because it's exactly or very brilliant classes, all of them are. And I am congratulating you, sir, for the great opportunity given to the children like us for a learning. And another one this evening was very good, because I came yesterday and I just travel everywhere and just go around the Niyas today after the lunch and just fresh up and come here. The lecture, what you said is, I can just imagine how the future be. Because the system which is following in the rural areas, but I am coming from a very rural area in Kerala. There is the system they followed is much different from the system which followed in Bangalore. Okay, I will just stop it. Because now government in Kerala, they are implementing the technology, international schooling. They are just making the difference in the building, what the school is. There is no difference in the teachings. And we tried to make a difference in our school. We started a WhatsApp group and Facebook group. We shared everything in that groups. But the response from the students from another schools is much different, because they are saying that this is not worst. Nobody take care of it, and they are just looking it and avoid it. But I think it is not very good. Okay, I'm stopping this by congratulating the Anand sir, and you make much more improvement. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bhuvana, yes.
Good evening, dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, and my dear friends. Today I'm very happy that I won the Niyas Maya Prodigy Fellowship. 3 months back I got to know about this fellowship and I applied to it. One thing that makes me very happy is that we had a lot of rounds which finally concluded the winners of this Prodigy Fellowship. But in all those rounds, I did something very unique. Like, I did everything with love for and passion for my subject. Like, the Niyas Maya Prodigy Fellowship did not aim on judging us on our marks, but in our hidden talents and our inner talents, which is unique in each and every kid. And this, as I won this, this has brought back confidence in my life. There will be many ups and downs in everybody's life, and happening of this fellowship in my life has been a very, very big thing, and I thank Niyas for this. And of course, as Anand sir said, improving the education and the technology by 2030, that is really, really very great, and I'm very happy that I came here and I got to know so much about it, and I'm definitely going to learn about it more. And thank you so much, everyone. I thank my parents a lot for this, for the support they have given me. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Reshma Ram.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I just want to thank everyone here, especially the people on the dais, because this opportunity has been very grateful. I cannot express how thankful I am, because this has been very unique. From the beginning, every round, as she said, it has been, it has judged me based on my special abilities, which is the aim of this program. So I want to congratulate everyone, my fellow awardees. This has been a program which has not just focused on marks or academics. It has focused on other special skills. So I want to tell, the future aspirants, that you just have to believe in yourself and make sure that you don't try to do anything that you don't want to do at heart. You should somehow, contribute to the society, because that's what's needed. And the education system, yes, I believe it has to progress. And I agree, and I know that all of you agree with me, because all of us have been in this rut, a routine, and we have to break from it. Thank you. I sincerely thank everyone here. Thank you.
Som Shekhar.
Good evening to all the dignitaries present on the dais, and also the audience who have gathered here for this evening. And this evening is one of the most remarkable evenings in my life as well, because I was very excited to receive the prize. Now, I'm more excited because of the lecture by Dr. Anant Agarwal as well. Because, is education for the future. Today, in today's scenario, there are a lot of problems that has to be solved. Because, I want to pursue my interest in engineering. And he said, you can't take courses from, all the prestigious universities in the world. And, being in India, getting best engineering education is from the IITs. And you spend a lot of two years of hard preparation and get into IITs. And due to some mistakes or some misconceptions, don't get IITs. And I think edX is providing that platform for everyone who has missed on to going on to IITs or some institutes and pursue engineering. And there are a lot of people who have been doing so. And also, I would like to thank NIAS and Iyengar Foundation National College for encouraging us to innovate something or go on to the future. Thank you, everyone.
I request the dignitaries to felicitate Dr. Anant Agarwal. I call upon Dr. Anita Kurup to deliver the vote of thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think today we have had a wonderful program, and this program is a culmination of the efforts of several individuals, people who have been on stage, people who have been backstage, along with many of you all standing here. I think it's extremely important for us to acknowledge that we sincerely appreciate the time Dr. Anant Agarwal has taken off from his extremely busy schedule. Lot of messages for the youngsters, lot of messages to many of us in this room in terms of what life could be for us beyond what we are doing currently. A big thank you to you, and it was an excellent talk. This unique program was launched in 2007, and it was made possible by the generous support of Dr. Sadananda Maya. We deeply appreciate it. This year, the sponsors have been Dr. S.S. Iyengar and Dr. Baldev Raj, who wanted to sponsor 10 fellowships in the name of his mother, Amrit, who has been very supportive to him through his career. We really appreciate the efforts of everyone. The National Program of Gifted Education has received unstinted support from the director, Dr. Baldev Raj. There were several people who, in their own unique ways, have contributed to the award function, and I would like to thank Dr. Baldev Raj, Dr. Iyengar, Dr. Rama Rao, Dr. V.S. Ramamurthy, who have played an advisory role to set the process in motion. Personally, I would also want to thank Dr. Bikramjit Basu, who has been part of the selection committee during the final rounds of the interview. The NIAS Gifted Education team has worked really hard to set this process in place. We have been extremely keen that we will not allow any coaching classes to try and coach the students to be award winners. Every year we have been looking at innovating the process of selection and actually look at talent, and the team has really worked hard in evaluating the answer, the essay scripts. They have worked very hard during the application process, and I would want to say that Dr. Iyengar has come to India very early in May and personally collected about 500 top SSLC scorers, their names and addresses in Karnataka, and we have personally sent applications to them. Today, if you see that you have students from different parts of Karnataka, it has been a sole effort to make this particular program more representative of the different groups that we are talking. We do not believe in a gifted education program that the elite can alone access. We are working at ways in which we would be able to identify talent among the diverse groups of people that we have in this country. And we are working, we are learning in the process. I would also want to thank Dr. Rama Rao and his team in National College, who basically gave us huge administrative support, because the essays were written by over 406 students. All of them, most of them, had scored over 95% in their SSLC exams. And during the interviews, we had two panels and we had about 40 students, and we made sure that we would choose the best. And these 15 students have come through an extremely competitive selection process. I would also want to thank Dr. Venugopal and his team, who have sort of organized the events today. The NIAS administrative team, who has always been excellent in putting things together. I would fail in my duty if I don't acknowledge the contribution of Dr. Sudarshan, who is a consultant. We have just very recently started the advanced learning centers for weekend classes in Bangalore South and North. And Sudarshan is spearheading this. And this is basically trying to identify the gifted children in the age group of the 5th, 6th and 7th grade. We hope we will give them the opportunities to be able to do things beyond what the school gives. And finally, I would want to say that I would thank each one of you, the students and the parents who have made it possible, this particular program. And if I have not mentioned names, it was not intentional at all. And in fact, everyone who has contributed to the program, a big thank you to you.
Thank you. We thank Dr. Rita for, I've been working through this program for the last 3 months. Professor Iyengar will present a bouquet, memento to Dr. Anita Kurup, and now finally, national anthem.
जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंधु गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जयदाता जनगण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे